الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، إن شاء الله تعالى as you can all see, inshallah ta'ala, these are the topics that I'm going to cover, inshallah ta'ala. And because the time is very short, I've only got 45 minutes, I won't be able to go through the whole topics. Or I won't be able to go in more detail, sorry. So inshallah ta'ala, I'm just going to go over each point, maybe one or two examples, and we'll keep it moving to the next one and the next one, inshallah ta'ala. Some words I might use, they might be slightly technical and hard for students to understand, but I will try my best to explain it, inshallah ta'ala. Inshallah, if the windows can be closed, inshallah, and just be patient for the... Inshallah ta'ala. This subject, so does everyone have the paper? Does anyone have it? If you've not got it, inshallah ta'ala, try to get one.
Someone got paper.
Paper don't have it. Here, brothers don't have it. Give it to brothers. You can just give him some. No, give him a lot. Take one, pass it on. So the first point that inshallah ta'ala that we're going to start with is طرق التفسير, which is types of tafsir or ways to do tafsir. There are five ways to do tafsir. There are what? There are five ways in which tafsir is done. The first one is تفسير القرآن بالقرآن, تفسير القرآن بالسنة, تفسير القرآن بأقوال الصحابة, سمتي بالصحابة with the ألف اللام, تفسير القرآن بأقوال التابعين. And last but not least, تفسير القرآن بالرأي والاجتهاد. So we'll go over them each with examples, inshallah ta'ala. The first one is تفسير القرآن بالقرآن. The Qur'an explains the Qur'an. So you come across a verse, and then you find that this verse is being explained somewhere else by another verse.
I said, can you hold it? Because the sisters can't hear you. Sorry, if you're speaking to
it. So the first one is تفسير القرآن بالقرآن, and it comes in many forms. I'm going to give you guys some examples. Three examples and we move on to the next one, inshallah ta'ala. And it comes, as I summarized, is 15 ways it comes. I'm just going to mention three of them. The first one is بيان المجمل. There comes an ambiguous verse. This verse is ambiguous. It's unclear. There's no way to implement this verse, or there's no way to understand it. It's mujmal, it's ambiguous, it's vague, it's not clear. Another verse comes and it explains it. For instance, if you go to the first ayah in Surah Al-Ma'idah, the first ayah in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Allah says, أُحِلَّتْ لَكُمْ بَهِيمَةُ الْأَنْعَامِ إِلَّا مَا يُتْلَى عَلَيْكُمْ. It is made permissible for you. Bahimatul An'am. Bahimatul An'am are the cattle, the cows, the goats, the camels, the behemoth al-an'am. Allah says, "Uhillat lakum," it's permissible for you. Illa, except ma yutla alaykum, except that which has been recited unto you. Unclear. What is it that's been? What's the exception now? What is it? Illa ma yutla alaykum, except that which has been recited unto you. What is it that's been recited unto us? This ayah, that part is ambiguous. It's not clear. So we have to go to the third ayah in Surah Al-Ma'idah, where Allah says, حُرِّمَتْ عَلَيْكُمُ الْمَيْتَةُ وَالْدَّمُ وَلَحْمُ الْخِنْزِيرِ وَمَا أُهِلَّ بِهِ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ وَالْمُنْخَنِقَةُ وَالْمَوْقُودَةُ وَالْمُتَرَدِّيَةُ وَالنَّقِيلِ. All of those types, the third verse, it explains to you what is meant by إِلَّا مَا يُتْلَى عَلَيْكُمْ. Is that clear? So now Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He's explaining for us one part of the other. Then the second example is, restricted and unrestricted verse. So the Quran comes, there's a verse which is unrestricted, it's unrestricted. Another verse comes and it restricts it. تقييد المطلق. تقييد المطلق. It restricts it. For example, Allah says in the Quran, إن الذين كفروا, those who have disbelieved, بعد إيمانهم, after their إيمان, ثم ازدادوا كفرا, and they have increased in disbelief, لن تقبل توبتهم, their repentance is not accepted. Pay attention here. Allah is saying in this verse, إن الذين كفروا, those who are disbelievers, بعد إيمانهم, they became disbelievers after their إيمان, then they increased in disbelief, their repentance is not accepted. So this shows us what? Anyone who apostates and he becomes hard-headed on his apostation, he's what? His repentance is not accepted. So if he says Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, basically based on this ayah, it's not accepted from him. Is that the case? So we have to go to the other ayah in the Quran. So the Quran explains itself. There is the repentance that is referred to that's not accepted from them is explained. The ayah, by the way, the first ayah was in Surah Ali Imran, ayah 90. The second ayah that explains it is Surah An-Nisa, ayah 18, where Allah says, وَلَيْسَتِ التَّوْبَةُ لِلَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ السَّيِّئَاتِ حَتَّى إِذَا حَذَرَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتِ قَالَ إِنِّي تُوبُتُ الْآنِ. That the repentance that is not accepted is when death comes to them and they're about to die. حَتَّى إِذَا حَذَرَ أَحَدَهُمُ الْمَوْتِ. It is when death is about to come to them and they are about to depart from this world. At this moment, their repentance is not accepted. Does that make sense now? So this ayah restricted, the second ayah restricted the unrestricted. Because the first ayah was unrestricted. It was saying that their repentance is not accepted. Unrestrictedly. But this ayah came and it restricted it to when? Hal, the situation of al-khuruj al-ruh, when the ruh is exiting the person. The third example, inshallah ta'ala, is the Quran, tafsir al-ghareeb. There's a strange word in a verse, very strange. This word is not commonly used in the Arabic language. So the ayah, another ayah comes and explains to you what this strange word means. For example, Allah says, وَأَمْتَرْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ. Allah says, we rained onto them hijaratan, stones, min sijil, from sijil. Now if I asked you what does the word sijil mean, you'd probably think to yourself, I don't know what it means. Because why? This word is a strange word. It's not commonly used. But then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, that ayah and the same story, Allah mentions what the word sijil means. He says, لِنُرْسِلَ عَلَيْهِمْ حِجَارَةً مِنْ طِيلٍ. Hijara, stone that is made from what? طِيل, which is clay. Are you with me? So the word sijil is what? The word sijil is what? Who explained it to us? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Either this is called tafsir al-ghareeb. So that's one form of tafsir of the Quran. That is one form of what? Tafsir of the Quran. And we need to, brothers, understand, you can't just take the Quran like that and play around with it. That the Quran, you need to understand by going to other ayat and explaining it with it. The second form is, if you look at your papers, is tafsir al-Quran bis-sunnah. Explaining the Quran based on the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala commanded him to explain the Quran to the people. وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. We have sent the Quran unto you, Muhammad, so you can clarify for the people. So the Prophet's job was what? Was to explain the Quran for the people sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are four ways in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam done tafsir of the Quran. Four ways. One is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he explains the ayah ibtida'an min nafsi, from himself. He initiates the answer. No one asks him, no one comes up to him, no one says, what does this ayah mean? He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam initiates the tafsir of this ayah. As he did with his companions, he said to them, when he read Surah Al-Kawthar, he said to them, أَتَدْرُونَ مَا الْكَوْثَرُ. Do you guys know what Kawthar is? So he's initiating. And the Sahabas, they said, Allahu wa Rasulu A'lam. Allah and His Messenger? No. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, نَهْرٌ. It's a river. وَعَدَنِيهِ اللَّهُ. In which Allah has promised it for me, the Day of Judgment. So who commented on it? And then the Prophet went on to say it, in it is عليه خير وبركه. In it is خير and baraka, good. This shows what? It's called tafsir. ابتداء من نفسه from himself عليه الصلاة والسلام. The second one is tafsir that the companions didn't know what this ayah meant. أشكل عليهم. It became unclear to them. And they didn't know what it meant. Such as قوله تعالى, the statement of Allah, الذين آمنوا ولم يلبسوا إيمانهم بظلم أولئك لهم الأمن وهم مهتدون. Surah Al-An'am, Ayah 82. Allah says, الذين آمنوا, those who believe, ولم يلبسوا إيمانهم بظلم, and they do not clothe their iman with what? Oppression. Allah says, for verily those people, they have what? They have safety, and they are truly the guided ones. Now pay attention to this, because nowadays we find people who do tafsir of the Quran based on the Arabic language alone. And look how the problem is right now. The Sahabas are Arabs, and the Arabic language is their language. As the poet said, لست بنحوي يلوك لسانه ولكني سليقي أقول فأعرب. He said, I'm not a grammarian. Arab Bedouin said, I am not a grammarian. When I speak, I get it right. Because I'm an Arab. This is my language. Just like you guys don't know, a lot of us don't know the English grammar. But when we hear somebody speak, when they say something wrong, we'll say, you got it wrong. Why? I don't know, but it's wrong. It doesn't sound right. So the Sahabas, the Arabic language and everything was naturally for them. It's just something Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, because it's their language. So when they looked at the ayah, look at how they pondered on the ayah. Alladina amanu, those of you who believe. Alladina amanu. Walam. Lam is what in the Arabic language? It's a negation. Walam. It's a negation. Pay attention to the qa'idah that's going to come out for me. Walam yalbisu imana. And they do not clothe their iman what? بِظُلْمٍ. ظُلْمٍ is what? It's an indefinite word. It's a nakira. It's not a mu'arraf. It's indefinite word. Meaning the tanween in there, it's called tanween al-tankir. The tanween in there grammatically is called what? Tanween al-tankir. Meaning it's an indefinite word. And what's the principle in the Arabic language? If an indefinite comes in the context of a negation, shows what? Generalization. Pay attention to this. Bidhulmin is an indefinite word. Before it is what? Lam is before it, which is a negation. So we have here an indefinite. Before it is a negation. The qa'idah and the principle was what? It shows what? Generalization in the Arabic language. So the Sahabas are saying, Ya Rasulullah, if the ayah is this, then it means anyone who comes with any form of oppression, it doesn't matter, they are what? They're not going to find safety, and they're not guided. Sahih? They look at it at a general meaning. That's how the Sahabas looked at it. And that's why they became scared, Ya Rasulullah, because they're saying, Ya Rasulullah, أَيُّنَا لَمْ يَظْلِمْ نَفْسَهُ. Who is it from amongst us who has not oppressed himself? Because they took the generalization, what? General. And that's what the ayah shows. So if you follow the Arabic language as the only basis, and you go against the sunnah, it's a problem. The Prophet ﷺ said to them, no. He said, have you not heard the statement of Luqman al-Hakim? Which is what? Inna shirka la zulmun azim. Shirk is the greatest oppression. So the ayah, alladhina amanu wa lam yalbisu imanahum bi zulmin. The zulm here is referring to shirk. And it's not general as you thought. Are you with me? Who did tafsir here? Who did tafsir? The messenger. Why did he do the tafsir for? Ashkala ala sahaba. This became unclear to the companions who were what? Arabs. You see how important it is. The third type is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he recites the ayah and he implements physically implements it. That becomes the tafsir for the ayah. The ayah comes down at that time and the Prophet does something right after the ayah. Are you with me? For example, that which he did in the Battle of Badr, alayhi salatu wa salam, when he did سَيُهُزَمُ الْجَمْعُ وَيُوَلُّونَ الدُّبُرُ. He read the ayah in the Battle of Badr. سَيُهُزَمُ الْجَمْعُ, the army will break into pieces and Allah will destroy them. وَيُوَلُّونَ الدُّبُرُ, and they will turn their backs. And they will what? And they will turn its back. Also, if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he does the tafsir, salawatullahi wa sallamun alayhi, by a situation he's currently going through, such as when he became old alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah commanded him what? And death was about to come close, what did he do? He started to increase or what? He started to increase by doing istighfar. Because Allah said to him, فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ. Exalt Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and come with what? Al-istighfar. So these are ways that the Prophet ﷺ explains the Quran. The other type of tafsir is the tafsir of the Sahabas. The Sahabas, they comment on the ayah. The tafsir of who? The Sahabas. What we really need to understand is the tafsir of the Sahabas and how they comment on the Quran. We need to keep these points in mind first. First of all, the Sahabas within themselves, are they all equal or are they different in statuses and ranks? The Sahabas are mutafawituna fi al-fadli wal-ilm. The way they are different in knowledge, in virtue, they were also different in knowledge. And they were not all the same. Pay attention to this. This is a principle you need to remember. كَمَا أَنَّهُمْ مُتَفَاوِتُونَ فِي الْفَضْلِ. The way they are of different ranks when it comes to virtue, they are also on different levels when it came to knowledge. That's the first point that you need to know. The second point that you need to know is, the Sahabas, when it came to the Qur'an, they were of three levels. The Sahabas, when it came to the Qur'an, they were of three levels. There were those who were referred to the what? The Mukthirun, who used to comment on the Qur'an excessively. Ibn Abbas, Ibn Mas'ud, Ubay, Ali ibn Abi Talib. These were the ones you would say the Mukthirun. In the Kutub al-Tafasir, you would find their Tafasir the most. And they commented on the Qur'an the most. The second one are the mutawassituna, they are the middle stage, who commented on the Qur'an. And they are kashshaykhayni Abi Bakr and Umar. Abu Bakr and Umar were not mukthirun. And there were reasons why. Because they had the wilayah of the Muslimin. They were governing the Muslims and they were controlling the Muslim affairs. Especially Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Because as soon as the Prophet died, he was dealing with the apostation of the Arabs and those who left Islam. So he's from the mutawassitun. Umar radiallahu anhu, the same, he was from the mutawassitun. Uthman radiallahu anhu was from the mutawassitun. Zayd is from the mutawassitun. Abu Musa al-Ash'ari is from the mutawassitun. Abdullah ibn Zubayr, he was from the mutawassitun. And then there comes the third stage, which were the muqillun, those who were little in their narration. He would not narrate a lot. Such as Abdullah, they don't have much tafasir or commentary on the ayat. كابن عمر وجابر وعبد الله بن عمر ابن العاص رضي الله تعالى عنهم أجمعين. So once you know the level and you understand that, it becomes beneficial for you when it comes to الترجيح, when their statements go against each other. Whose statements takes precedence over who and how do you reconcile between it? The scholars of tafasir, the sahabas who had tafasir, the greatest person when it came to tafsir, who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's dua hit, and who was the highest of them, is Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Amma radiallahu ta'ala anhu, may Allah be pleased with him and his father. First of all, he had virtue over the other companions when it came to tafsir. The reason why he done is, number one, لِدُعَاءِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ, the Prophet made dua specifically for him. And we know the Prophet's dua is accepted or not? Accepted. The second one is وَلِمُلَازَمَتِهِ, and the fact that he was always with the kibar al-sahaba. He spent time with the great noble companions such as Abu Bakr and Umar. He spent time with them. The third virtue that Abdullah ibn Abbas had over the other companions was because he died, وَلِتَأَخُّرِ وَفَاتِهِ, he died very late in his age. And this is something you get over the rest. It's because you see the other Sahabas, what they said on their tafsir, and you can see where you should go and round it, and if they were right or wrong. Because when the Prophet died, he was how old? Abdullah ibn Abbas. Some said he was 13. Some said he was 15. And the oldest is that they said he was 17. So he was very young when the Prophet died. So he had the chance to get the Prophet's dua. Are you with me? Number one, he also had the chance to meet the great noble companions who were the fuqaha, who were the ulama, Abu Bakr and Umar and whatnot. And he also had the chance of living after all of them, which is to spend more time in the Quran. لذلك الشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية in his مقدمة في أصول التفسير he mentions, الشيخ الإسلام mentions that when Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was alive, Ibn Mas'ud was more knowledgeable than Ibn Abbas in tafsir. Based on the statement of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, in which Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, ما من آية في كتاب الله إلا وأنا أعلم أين نزلت وفي من نزلت وأين نزلت. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, there is not an ayah that came down except I know who it came down on, when it came down and why it came down, everything about it. And if I was to know anyone more knowledgeable than me in the tafsir of the Quran, in which my riding beast can reach him, I would go and take the tafsir from him. Ibn Abbas was alive at that time. Why did Ibn Mas'ud say that? The scholars, they say, is because at the time of Ibn Mas'ud was the most knowledgeable when it came to tafsir. But then Ibn Taymiyyah added something beneficial on it, which is Abdullah ibn Abbas lived after Ibn Mas'ud 30 years after. Ibn Abbas lived 30 years after Ibn Mas'ud. And he gathered a lot of knowledge. He gathered what? He gathered a lot of information and a lot of understanding. And this is one of the virtues that he has, that some people think that it's necessarily good to die quickly. If Allah gives you a good long life and that you can benefit yourself, then it's better than dying a short life where you don't benefit from it. The fourth type is the tafsir of the aqwal of the tabi'een. The aqwal of the tabi'een. The tabi'een are the students of the companions. This is the fourth stage of tafsir of the Qur'an. So we do tafsir al-Qur'an bil Qur'an. Then we go for tafsir al-Qur'an bil Sunnah. And then we go for tafsir al-Qur'an bi aqwal al-Sahaba. And then the fourth stage is bi aqwal al-tabi'een, the statement of the students of the companions. We need to categorize the schools of the tabi'een into three. So you have an understanding. The madaris, the schools that were out there at the time, were three schools. There were the madrasatu ahl Makkah, the madrasa and the school of the people of Mecca, and the madrasa of the people of Medina, and then we have the madrasa of the people of Iraq. And then we realize each of them. The people of Mecca, their imam was Abdullah ibn Abbas. The people of Mecca, who was their teacher? Abdullah ibn Abbas, radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he brought out his student, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, who died 95 Hijriah, and Mujahid ibn Jabr, who died 104, and Ikrimah, who died the year 105, and Tawus ibn Kaysan, who died 106, and Ata' ibn Abi Rabah, who died 115. And the people of Mecca were the most knowledgeable when it came to tafsir. وَأَهْلُهَا أَعْلَمُ النَّاسِ بِالتَّفْسِيرِ. They were the most knowledgeable. Ibn Abbas' students were the most knowledgeable. If we've proved that Ibn Abbas was the most knowledgeable in tafsir from the companions, then of course his students are going to be what? ولذلك from his students is Mujahid ibn Jabr, who died in the year 104, who Sufyan al-Thawri said, إِذَا جَاءَكَ تَفْسِيرُ مُجَاهِدٍ فَحَسْبُكَ بِهِ. If the tafsir of Mujahid comes to you, then enough. Don't look for more. That's enough for you. Why? So now we have the students of who? The students of Ibn Abbas are the most knowledgeable, correct? From within the students of Ibn Abbas, Mujahid was the elected one. Why was he the elected one? Because he said, عَرَضْتُ الْمُصْحَفْ عَلَى ابْنِ عَبَّاسِ. He said, I opened the Mus'haf on Abdullah ibn Abbas. ثَلَاثُ عَرَضَاتِ, three times from beginning to end. أُوْقِفُ عِنْدَ كُلِّ آيَةِ. Every verse I stop him. What's the tafsir of this ayah? What's the tafsir of this ayah? What's the tafsir of this ayah? What's the tafsir of this? Of this ayah. Are you with me? لذلك, there's a great noble scholar. I don't know if you guys know him. الشيخ محمد الأمين الشنقيطي. Do you guys know him? صاحب أضواء البيان. شيخ محمد الأمين الشنقيطي, he was doing, have you guys read his كتاب دفع الإيهام؟ محمد الأمين الشنقيطي wrote a كتاب where all the verses that seem like they're contradicting each other from the apparent, they look like they're contradicting. Are you guys with me? محمد الأمين الشنقيطي, what he does is he reconciles the verses to show you that the verses are what? That they come together. And this idea came to him, if you read the مقدمة he mentions, this idea came to him whilst he was in what? Whilst he was in Hajj. He was in Hajj. Sorry. Whilst he was in I'tikaf, sorry. While he was in what? An I'tikaf. Muhammad ibn al-Shaqiti did not have anything with him except the Mus'haf. He was reading the Mus'haf. And every ayah he came, he wrote it down, that seemed like it was contradicting another ayah. Seemed like. Because we know the Qur'an does not contradict one another. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. If this Qur'an came from anybody other than Allah, you would find what? Contradiction from it. What amazed me from this book, because I read it last night, because for this topic, just went over again. Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqita rahimahullah, what he does is, when you read that book, what's one of the amazing things is, he brings an ayah that explains another ayah. So if this ayah seemed like it was contradicting, he explains it with another ayah. And then guess what he does? He brings a hadith that reconciles the two. I'll give you guys one example. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, وَجُوهُ يَوْمَيْذٍ نَاظِرًا إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرًا. Allah tells us that the day of judgment, that eyes are going to see Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And these are the eyes of the who? The believers. Are you with me? The believers are going to see Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Then we have another ayah which the Mu'tazila and other deviated groups bring, and they say, لَا تُدْرِكُهُ الْأَبْصَارِ وَهُوَ يُدْرِكُ الْأَبْصَارِ. Allah cannot be, He cannot fully be perceived with the eyes. لَا تُدْرِكُهُ الْأَبْصَارِ. So they say, how can you say that Allah is going to be seen when there's this ayah, لَا تُدْرِكُهُ الْأَبْصَارِ. Muhammad ibn Shaqir brings a hadith that reconciles the two ayahs together. How does he do that? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, did he not say alayhi salatu wa sallam, إِنَّكُمْ سَتَرَوْنَ رَبَّكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, that you guys will see your Lord the day of judgment, كَمَا تَرَوْنَ الْقَمَرَ, the way you guys see the full moon, لَا تُضَامُونَ فِي رُؤْيَتِي, in which there is no cloud or mist between you and seeing it. Are you with me? Many of you guys haven't seen what Muhammad ibn Shaqir just saw from this. What did he see? You can't do, you can see the moon, but can you fully comprehend it? Does that make sense? So the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reconciled between what? That the moon can be seen, but it can't fully be perceived. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. And Allah has a what? A high and a great example. Are you with me, brothers? So this is a religion which is, just as a side benefit, I am trying to not be too technical and too much information. It's a benefit that I needed, and you guys are meant to be students of knowledge. And I was told today to make it into a lesson and a class. If you look at these man-made laws, these qawaneen al-wad'iyya, these man-made laws, if each of these laws, you look at them individually, pay attention to this. This is a mas'ala, لابد أن نتدبر بها. It's a matter that we need to ponder on. If you look at laws, and those of you who studied it will know, man-made law, if you look at it individually, pay attention, this is point is very important, brothers. If you look at man-made law individually, each law, if you look at it individually, those laws that were set, if that it happens that it occurs in one person all at the same time, you realize that the man-made law starts to contradict itself. Pay attention to this. Are you there? Are you allowed to kill somebody by way of self-defense in this country? Are you with me? Somebody wants to attack you, wants to kill you, and they want to do something, can you self-defend yourself and kill him in return? Huh? In this country, is it allowed? Yeah, self-defense, they allow you to. Somebody wants to kill you. He's got a sharp weapon, wants to kill you. In order to defend yourself, they give you rights of self-defense. Are you with me? Now that is a law they have. What about if a man comes into another person's house and wants to steal, and he gets caught, and this person who saw him in the house wants to kill him. Now what happened? And he wants his self-defense now. You own somebody else's property. Self-defense was by itself was allowed for you. Now you're in somebody else's property. He wants to kill you, not get rid of you and take you out of the house or call the police on you. He wants to kill you and you self-defense. What happens now? What happened? What I want from this, brothers, is that issues when they do taza'um in the Sharia, Islam is the only religion, when they come together, the principles are still consistent. ولذلك that's the tafsir of the ayah. Muhammad ibn Shaqir said, وَلَوْ كَانَ مِنْ عِنْدِ غَيْرِ اللَّهِ لَوَجَدُوا فِيهِ اخْتِلَافًا كَثِيرًا. If it was from other than Allah, you find what? Contradiction. Allah's religion, لا. And that's why the scholars, they have books called Alish Ashbah wal Nadair, Al Furuq, where they talk about things that are similar to one another, when they do happen and they There's answers for it. The last one, inshallah ta'ala, which is tafsir al-Qur'an bil-ra'i wal-ijtihad. No, sorry. The second people, the second school of thought amongst the tabi'een are who? Ahlul Medina. And their imam was Ubay ibn Ka'b, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And with him, of course, was Zayd and Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. They are the scholars of Medina. From their students is Abu al-Aliyat al-Rayahi, Muhammad ibn Ka'b al-Quradi, Zayd ibn Aslam al-Madani, Malik ibn Anas. These ones, the people of Medina, they were not the most knowledgeable when it came to tafsir, but they were the most knowledgeable when it came to the maghazi, when it came to the history and the tarikh and the biography. They gave precedence of the people of Medina. Sorry, the people of Mecca. They were given more precedence over it. Even the qira'at, the recitation of the Qur'an, they take precedence over the people of Mecca. And this is important, brothers, because the reason why I'm pointing this out is عند الترجيح. When the khilaf comes, you know who to give precedence to. The third one are Ahlul Iraq, the people of Iraq. And Ubay ibn Ka'b was also their imam. Zayd and Abu Sa'id al-Khudri and other than them were also their imam. But Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was the one who governed them fully. Majority of their fatawat and their views was from Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And from his students is Alqamah ibn Qais, Masruq ibn al-Ajdam, Ajda', what do you call it, al-Sha'bi, Hasan al-Basri, Qatadat ibn Da'abat al-Sadusi, and other than them. And the people of Iraq, from them came Madrasatul Ra'i. Madrasatul Ra'i, where Abu Hanifa and other than them came from it later, this is where it occurred from. Now we're going to move on to the issue of the Ijma' and the Khilaf of at-tafsir. The Ijma' and the Ikhtilaf in tafsir. As you know, the Khilaf that occurs in the tafsir, difference of opinion, are bound to happen. Because Allah said in the Quran, وَلَا يَزَالُونَ مُخْتَلِفِينَ إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبُّكَ وَلِذَلِكَ خَلَقَهُمْ. That the people are bound to differ. But what we need to understand is, Shaykh al-Islam Taymiyyah elaborated on his muqaddimah, in his usul al-tafsir, is that the khilaf amongst the ulama in tafsir, the majority of it is ikhtilaf al-tanawu', la ikhtilaf al-tabad. This is something you need to keep in mind. That a lot of the times, the difference of opinions that occur in tafsir, the majority of it, are not really differences that are, that each party is going to different directions. It is differences which you can reconcile between them. It's differencing in just wordings, not in the true concept. Are you with me? Give you an example. What falls under that is ta'rifu shay'i bi ba'di ajza'ihi. Defining something, explaining something from some of its parts. A brother comes up to you and says to you, have you met Abdurrahman, the tall brother? And I am tall brothers. Another brother comes up to you and says to you, have you met brother Abdurrahman, the Somalian brother? Another brother comes up to you and says to you, have you met the brother Abdurrahman, the dark-skinned brother? How many descriptions have they put on me? Is it ikhtilaf? It is ikhtilaf. In the wedding, meaning everyone has chosen something that the other one hasn't. So there is differences. But are they differing on who they're talking about? And everyone has chosen a part of me or a description of mine, and they've chosen to describe me by it. Does that make sense? The majority of the tafasir are like that. Are you with me? And it is not ikhtilaf al-tabad, where they're differing in the sense where you can't reconcile between it. That one person is talking about another Abdurrahman, and one's talking about another Abdurrahman. Does that make sense? So it has al-mujba alay and that which have been differed on. Due to the short time, we're going to, inshallah ta'ala, go to the qawa'id, inshallah ta'ala, the principles that are needed. The qawa'id, inshallah ta'ala. Yarhamuk Allah. The qawa'id are two types. Qawa'id, which are qawa'id amma, general principles that you need to know, and qawa'id which are tarjihiyya. And I'll mention that when I come to it, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. Brothers, i'lam, have understanding and comprehensions. Allamani Allah wa iyyakum, may Allah teach me and all of you the importance of having principles, wallahi, brothers. It is very important for a student of knowledge to have usul kulliya taridu ilayhi al-juz'iyat. You have comprehensive principles where all the sub branches, they come back to that principles for you. Are you with me? You should have it. It saves you from having to run around and stand over every sub branch. You can't. Your life is too short to study each sub branch. So study the comprehensive principles. And what will happen is that you can bring all of the juz'iyat back to these principles. And that is why I thought it was very important that I specifically narrowed out a point which is قاعدة عامة أما قواعد كلية. The first one is العبرة بعموم اللفظ لا بخصوص السبب, which is in tafsir we give consideration to the generalization of the wording, not on the specific situation in which it came down onto. Pay attention to this. An ayah came down on somebody. For instance, let's take the Quran itself as an example. The ayah inna shari'aka huwa al-abtar. We know it came down on Al-As ibn Wa'il, who belittled the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. First, inna shari'aka huwa al-abtar means your lineage is disconnected. It's a curse. The one who insults the Prophet, inna shari'aka huwa al-abtar. You're not going to carry on, inshallah. You're going to come to an end. So this ayah, it came down on who? Al-As ibn Wa'il, who specifically slandered the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. Do we have people slandering the Prophet and speaking against him right now and calling him names? Do we say that this ayah is specific to Al-As ibn Wa'il? We don't say that. We say is what? We use this qa'ida, which is what? Al-ibra bi'umum al-lafz la bi-khusus al-sabab. We look at the generalization of the wordings, not the reason in which it came down on. Because if we do that, then that would mean every ayah, whoever it came down on, is specific to him, and the Quran does not apply in this 21st century at all. Does that make sense? The Quran doesn't apply anymore. It's finished. It's ended. It came down on Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and the disbelievers of Quraysh. It's no place for us. The second qa'idah, brothers, is al-aslu fi al-ayati al-ihkam. فَلَا يُقَالُ بِالنَّسْخِ إِلَّا عِنْدَ اتِّفَاءِ حُكْمِهَا. This qa'idah is very important. This qa'idah is very, very important in the sense where two people are discussing a matter, we need to realize that the ayat are muhkam, they're not abrogated. And so the person who says this ayat is not abrogated, he doesn't have to bring evidence. Because the asal is what? That the ayat are not abrogated until proven it's abrogated. And that the ayat are implemented. Are you with me, brothers? So this is a refutation, and Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah elaborated on this in more details in his Majmu' al-Fatawa. Are you with me? Elaborated, Ibn al-Qayyim also in his I'lam, he elaborated on it more, which is the issue of ayatu as-saif, al-amru bis-sabr. The people to be patient. Is it abrogated with the verses of the sword? The ayat which say be patient, you know, because those ayat that command you to be patient, they were in Mecca. And the Prophet moved to Medina, and when he moved to Medina, can we say that the ayat in Mecca that was speaking about be patient, فَاصْفَحْ عَنْهُمْ وَقُلْ سَلَامٌ وَأَعْرِضْ عَنِ الْجَاهِلِينَ, turn away from the Arab, you know, can we say that those ayat are now abrogated on the ayat that came in Medina? Are you with me? The ayat which say, فَإِذَا سَلَخَ الْأَشْهُرُ الْحُرُمَ فَاقْتُلُوا الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَيْثُ وَجَدْتُمُوهُمْ وَخُذُوهُمْ وَاحْصُرُوهُمْ وَاقْعُدُوا لَهُمْ كُلَّ مَرْصَدٍ. Do we say that these ayats abrogated the previous ayat? We say no. We say, فَإِنْ آيَاتُ الصَّبْرِ, the verses of patience, because the asl is what? الْأَصْلُ فِي الْآيَةِ الْإِحْكَامِ, that the ayah is muhkam, that it's not abrogated. That's the original ruling. That's the original ruling. And there's no reason for it to be abrogated. The reason is because the ayats that are referring to, the ayats that are referring to patience, still apply when we go through the same situation that the Prophet went through in Mecca. And those ayats are applied on us. So if the Muslims become weak, like the Prophet was weak in Mecca, ayatul sabr are commanded the believers to come with. Are you with me? And that ayatul saif is عند القوة, when strength is there. And Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, ibn al-Qayyim, and other than them, fassalu, they spoke about it in more details. So those are qawa'id. The other qa'idah, which is the third qa'idah I need to mention, is Mura'atu siyaq, observing the context is very important, unless there is what illa bidalilin, unless there's an evidence that doesn't allow you to do it. But you have to. Don't bring an ayah and say, I'm not going to observe the context. Because some of the scholars, they differ upon the ayah, وَمَا قَدَرُ اللَّهَ حَقَّ قَدْرِهِ إِذْ قَالُوا مَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ عَلَى بَشَرٍ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Some said it came down on the Yahud. And some said, لَا, it came down on what? في مُشْرِكِي قُرَيْش. Who is more right? The ones who said that it came down on Mushriki Quraysh are right. Why are they right? Because the surah is surah Makkiyah, and the siyaq and the context was speaking about, speaking to who? It is what? في مجادلة مشركي قريش. It was in the argumentation towards Kufar of Quraysh. So the siyaq tells us who he's referring to. The other one which I have to mention, which is إبقاء الآيات على ظاهرها إلا بدليل والمقصود بالظاهر هنا المعنى المفهوم. The ayah should be left at its apparent meaning. The ayah, the asl is that we leave it at its apparent meaning. And we don't go to what? We don't go to any other meaning other than it. For example, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تَذْبَحُ الْبَقَرَى. Allah commands you to slaughter the cow. We know what the cow is. We take it for zahir, which is al-haywan, al-ma'roof, the known animal, the cow. You don't need to go into it. And we don't do it as the Sufiya say, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُكُمْ أَن تَذْبَحُ بَقَرَ. They said, Baqara means your nafs. Slaughter yourself. In the sense where with ibadat and ta'at, that's what they said. The Shia came and they said, the Baqara is Aisha. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا لَا رَجِعُونَ. Then here, the ayat has left its ظاهر. إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَجِعُونَ. Does that make sense? So anyone can come and take the ayah from its apparent meaning and play around with it. The asr, my brothers, is al-ظاهر. And also when Allah tabarak wa ta'ala said, بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبْسُوطَتَان. Both of the hands Allah are open, we leave it at its ظاهر. Which are what? That they are both يَدَانِ لِلَّهِ تَلِيقَانِ بِجَلَالِ. They befit His Majesty. And we don't say that, are they هُمَا نِعْمَتَانِ هُمَا قُدَرَتَانِ. We don't say this. We leave it at its ظاهر. Because the kalam, the asal of the speech, is to leave it at its ظاهر. If I say to, I saw a lion, mean I saw a lion. Don't say you saw a courageous person or I just said you saw a lion. Leave it the way it is. Unless within the context I say I saw a lion and I hugged him. And you know I can't hug a lion unless he's dead. The siyaq, the context, narrowed it down for you. Does that make sense? Also another issue which is al-asru mura'atu ma'hud al-Qur'an. Another thing which is very important, and I find this especially when I used to look into the issues of Qadiyatul Niqab, is the Niqab wajib or is it not? This is a mas'ala that needs to be, huh? Which is observing the Qur'an's usage of a word. If the Qur'an always uses this word, because the scholars, they differ on the ayah, وَلَا يُبْدِينَ زِينَتَهُنَّ, that the woman should not make her zina apparent. Some of the scholars, they say the zina means her face and her hands. And that's the opinion, And some say the zina here is meant what? By the what? By the clothing which she wears. Something over, other than her. Does that make sense? So we need to look at the ma'hud al-Qur'an. When we look at the Qur'an, what is the most common usage of the word zina when he used it? What's the most common usage of the word zina? خُذُوا زِينَتَكُمْ عِنْدَ كُلِّ مَسْجِدٍ. Take your beauty with you. What does it mean here? Clothing. Are you with me? وَلَا يَضْرِبْنَ بِأَرْجُلِهِنَّ لِيُعْلَمَ مَا يُخْفِينَ مِنْ زِينَتِهِنَّ. So the ma'hud of the Qur'an, and that which is very well known for, is the what? Is this. So those who said that the niqab is wajib, which I am inclined to that opinion, this should not have been a proof for them. Or an argument which they put forward. Because this goes against the ma'hud of the Qur'an. Finally, inshallah ta'ala, the last point, inshallah ta'ala, that I'm going to conclude with is tanbihat muhimma liman arad al-qira'at fi kutub al-tafsir. Some important points, inshallah, and guidelines for a person who wants to study the books of tafsir and wants to read the books of al-tafsir. Some of the points, inshallah ta'ala, is, and I saw this very commonly and it's very well known by many people, which is qira'ati, to read muqaddimatul mu'allif. Reading the introduction of the mu'allif, his tafsir book. You read Tafsir Ibn Kathir, right? Ibn Kathir has a muqaddimah on his tafsir. Read the muqaddimah to know his manhaj. And his tariqah, the way he's going to tread on his tafsir, and how is he going to do it? You see a person come up to you and say to you, Akhi, you ask him, have you read the muqaddimah of the tafsir of the Kathir? He says, I've never read it. He just wants to open the tafsir and he wants to read it. And base the methodology on his way of how he sees it. La. If you want to read tafsir book, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, Imam al-Baghawi, Ibn Kathir, I'll read the muqaddimah. They will tell you what they're going to do here. And they will give you an understanding of it. The second point is that the person has to realize is or know to study the qira'ah or to know the qira'ah that the mufassir is going to use for his tafsir. Is he going to use hafs? Is he going to use warsh? Which qira'ah or which type of recitation is he going to use? The third one is to know the aqeedah of the author. اعتقاد المؤلف. His aqeedah, what kind of aqeedah does he have? ومذهبه فقهي. Also try to understand what madhab fiqhi is he upon. Because why? This will affect his tafsir. Your aqeedah affects your tafsir. Are you with me? Because the asal of the mubtadi'ah, the people of innovation is what? يعتقدون ثم يستدلون فيضلون. They have a belief. The aqeedah is there. They'll make the ayah follow the aqeedah. Whereas Ahlul Sunnah what? They look for the evidence, then the aqeedah comes out from the evidences. Are you with me? They already have a aqeedah in their mind and they want to use it based on the ayah. Another one is أَيَخْتَارَ الطَّبْعَ السَّلِيمَةِ. Choose a good publication of the book, the tafsir book that you want to study. وَالتَّحْقِيقِ الْمَتِينَ. Don't rely on a copy that is cheap. MashaAllah, it costs me very little money, so I'm going to benefit from this. It's very cheap. Don't do that. Buy a publication which is what? Buy a publication which is very good. Also, I'll give you guys an example of a point that I forgot. Ibn Jarir al-Tabri, when you read his tafsir, you realize that Ibn Jarir al-Tabri, when he says ijma', there's khilaf still in the matter. Ibn Jarir al-Tabri's ijma' is not a ijma' that you should take as though there's nobody who went against it. Are you with me? Ibn Jarir means by ijma' al-aktharun, the majority, and a jumhur. So his istilah and his usage of ijma' is not the one that you're going to understand as what? As the one that the usuliyin mentioned. Does that make sense? Also, the Ibn Jarir al-Tabari believed, pay attention to this issue, which is al-ijtihad ila yanqud al-ijtihad. That an ijtihad cannot nullify another ijtihad. Which basically, in a very nutshell, which means if a scholar has an opinion and then he changes his view and he brings another opinion, he believes all of those are his views. All of those are what? His view hasn't changed. Because the qa'idah to him is what? Al-ijtihad la yanqudhu al-ijtihad. Al-ijtihad does not nullify another ijtihad. Are you with me? So you need to know these istilahat of the scholar that you're going to look at. Last but not least is that the person should choose أَيَخْتَارَ أَجْمَعُ التَّفَاسِيرِ. Try to look for the most comprehensive tafsir book. The most comprehensive tafsir book if you want to study the tafsir book. أَلَّا مَا لَا شَكْشَ فِيهِ. Without a doubt, the best tafsir book to ever read and to stand over, to study and to give time to is Tafsir Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. And this is the witness and this is the statement of who? الشيخ الإسلام بن تيمية رحمه الله and other him. His tafsir is tafsir al-ma'thur. So this is a khulasa tul khulasa. Summary of all of those points. I spoke fast. I went too much information. But anything which I have said that was wrong, فَإِنَّهُ مِنِّي وَمِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ وَاللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ بَرِيْآنِ مِنْهُ سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ بِحَمْدِكَ أَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ أَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَأَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ.
Brothers, I just want to say something very, very quickly. What Ustaz just went through, obviously, as time goes on, you're going to find many different people that are going to come out on YouTube. They're going to come and start doing tafsir of the Quran. Many different people, ila qiyam sa'ah. These are qawa'id that it wasn't Ustaz that just put it down. It was from the scholars before. So anytime someone comes and starts doing tafsir of the Quran, doing tafsir of the Quran is not a joke. It's something very, very serious. You need this qawa'id, you need this dawabit to put it in place. To see, is this person who's doing tafsir of the Quran is becoming mashhur, is becoming known to it?
Is he doing it in a correct way? Today people, wallahi, sallamu lahu. There's people, they have taken a person who is very well known on YouTube and things like that, and they seem to be the mufassir of this asr. Of this time, he is the mufassir. When the reality of the matter is, he might be in tafsir through the Arabic language. And he skipped part 1, 2, 3, 4 that our brother just went through. And they've seen this person, a person who does tafsir. And it's very, very dangerous because this is our Qur'an. Someone can come to you tomorrow and do tafsir of the Qur'an, a certain ayah. And it could be the reason why you slip out of the sunnah. Now that was just a ta'aliq. They don't want to take anything away from the brother.